This meets that. This meets that. You like this thing. I like that. This meets that. Put them together and what do you got? This meets that. This meets that. Hey!
Welcome everyone to another episode of This Meets That, a show where we take two movies, mash them up, and if you were to describe these movies, you would say, it's like this meets that. I'm Ben.
And I'm Steve.
And this is a fun little game that we like to play on our free time. You may know that by now. So we're going to pick two movies and try to pitch an idea of what the hell that those two movies can be. Do you have anything offhand? I do not.
I don't know why I picked this movie, but I'm going to go with it.
Okay, okay. Fuck it. All right. One, two, three.
Back to the Future. Hot Rod and Back to the Future.
Okay. So
I feel like they have a similar energy.
Sure. The relationship stuff. So
both comical.
Yeah, let me write that down. So all right, my initial automatic first thought is you have a stuntman, maybe he's a little bit older, kind of been in the game for a while, he's looking to retire, or maybe he's kind of a washed up stuntman. He's doing county fair stuff, things that are a little below him. He's getting kind of screwed on money because he's not really the draw that he used to be. He does maybe some one big like final stunt to really win everybody over. I don't know if it's jumping over 50 flaming school buses or what, jumping over a shark tank, something, but he does it, and for whatever reason he gets sent back in time, and now he's back in his heyday. Maybe it was something that he maybe kind of messed up and killed someone in a stunt, and that's why he fell out of favor. Mm-hmm. But now he gets a chance to kind of change his future and try to do things right. And I don't know if you play this for comedy or for drama, but maybe he keeps messing up and his life always gets bad and he's keeps going back in time to try to fix it. Or maybe, I don't know if there is like a person telling him the rules or if it's just one of those kind of Groundhog Day. Oh my God, how did this happen? I don't know. I got to figure out the rules as I go. You know, maybe you could have a Doc Brown type character. Maybe it was his trusty mechanic that's mm-hmm. been with him forever and is like, oh, I'm going to soup up your bike and, you know, put this new crazy device on it and it'll make the jump even easier. But it's actually a little time travel flux capacitor sort of thing. I don't know what he does though.
Yeah, so maybe kind of like a hot tub time machine thing where that it would be like the Chevy Chase character, but instead of like, because you're making your time machine something silly, so instead of the hot tub, it's the
little motorbike.
The motorbike that he uses. Yeah.
And maybe it's not a machine. Maybe it's the gas. You know, kind of like in Hot Tub Time Machine, how it was the energy drink. Maybe he put something in the tank that, so he's going in all these colorful smokes and sparks, and everybody thinks it's just a stunt, and then. Disappears into the past and everybody thinks he like blew up or something. I don't know.
Yeah. Okay. Here's my pitch. So you have a stuntman who is down in his luck and is doing, you know, these weekend shows at like county fairs and stuff, and you know, maybe some stunts don't go right. He's, you know, he's not like an old guy, but he's been like doing it for a little while, maybe in his 30s, and he's just like, you know, and he just fell in love with stunts watching Evel Knievel growing up and everything. And so he just kind of wanted to emulate that. But he's just like kind of, he's a young guy, but he's like tattered his body and his stunts are like either not exciting or just like don't really land very well. And he kind of, you know, and he carries a picture of like Evel Knievel in like his trailer or whatever as he goes to these fairs and stuff. He's like, man, if only I wish I could have like met this guy and like really, you know, just find out like what it means to like, be him. Like, I wish I was Evel Knievel. And then, you know, he's maybe thinks about killing himself and he's just like, I'm gonna die, you know, doing what I love. And he like purposely like tries, he goes to do like this stunt to like try and kill himself, but he lands it. But when he lands, he looks around and like everything's different. It's still like the county fair, but it's not as grand. And like, so he realizes that he has time traveled. And runs into Evil Knievel and gets to know him, and then Evil Knievel like kind of takes him under his wing and like shows him like stuntman stuff, and he kind of like learns a little bit more, and it's kind of more of a story about like, you know, being yourself and carving your own path, not emulating someone else. Like, you can take inspiration from them and like learn stuff from them, but really you need to do your own thing. And whether that is like, oh, maybe I won't be a stuntman, maybe I can just run the show and bring in new stuntmen and do crazy things or whatever it is. Or maybe he figures out like how to do stunts better and gets to know Evil Knievel. Maybe Evil Knievel's kind of, I don't know much about Evil Knievel.
Yeah.
So I don't know if he was like secretly a dick, or maybe he's just like the most gracious guy ever. And you kind of make it part biopic about Evil Knievel, but like obviously take liberties because like you're having Evil Knievel meet this character who like doesn't exist, and it's like a silly time travel story. Maybe it's one of those things where he's trying to decide like, ooh, do I stay here with someone who likes me and who I look up to and just work for him, or do I try and go back to my own time? I don't even know how to go back to my own time. And then by the end of the film and like the finale, where it's just like, all right, kid, you're gonna do this big stunt, and you know, he's conflicted, he's like, oh, like the stunt could kill me, and it's just like, you know, it's not about living or dying, it's not about landing the stunt or in dying, it's about truly living or something like that. You know, you never feel more alive than when you're doing this thing. He's like, yeah, you're right, this is why I fell in love with it. And then he like goes to do the big stunt and he lands and he's like, I did it. And then he looks around and he's back at the fair, kind of thing,
with an altered future, or back to his present life and learns to,
I think he's back at his present life. It's not like he did a big stunt and all of a sudden the crowd's like, you're the greatest, because I don't think like that's really earned. It's just like, okay, I've taken the lessons I've gotten from the past and I'm going to use that. And then maybe cut to a year later and then he's at a big show. It's a sold out crowd. And he's like, now, you know, this, not necessarily as big as Evil Knievel by any means, but maybe he's put on a cool show, or maybe he's doing stunts for movies now. It's gotten him a career that he loves doing and all that kind of stuff.
Okay. All right. I think if we're going to lean into the hot rod stuff more and make it a real dumb goofy comedy,
okay,
you take someone like a Andy Samberg, not Adam Sandler. God,
that same person, essentially.
No, not at all. Not at all.
I like Andy Sandler. Oh god. Andy Sandler. Whatever.
You take a silly Andy Samberg character who wants to be a stuntman, doesn't quite succeed at it, somehow steals a crazy bike from a nuclear scientist, you know, maybe he lives next door to NASA or something, soups up his bike to do the craziest thing, and you have him time travel way back. So maybe you have him driving around with dinosaurs chasing him, and he's just kind of like, I gotta get out of here. And he figures like maybe it's something with the speed or the RPMs. Yeah, you know, you reach a certain thing and then you hit a button and, oh, well, I was going 2,000 RPMs. I don't know.
Yeah.
And so it's like, oh, I went back 2,000 years. And it's like, you know, there's some sort of math into it. So it's like, oh, well, I keep going back. How do I get
forward? Well, dinosaurs were around 2,000 years ago.
Absolutely, yes. So. Yep. Jesus rode a T-Rex.
Yeah.
You know, whatever the rules are with the bike. And, you know, you have them hopping from ancient past into modern times. So it's like, you know, he's driving through the Salem witch trials or Juneteenth or something. I don't know. Yeah, ancient Rome, Pompeii, you know, you do a lot of like crazy fun spectacle things.
Yeah. And, it would be fun. Like he lands on, he goes back in time. He's like, where the hell am I? He's kind of like on this rocky surface, and then he hears grumblings, and then it's just him like riding the motorcycle down the mountain as Pompeii is exploding. That would be cool.
Amazing. Yeah. You could do silly things of him like, you know, he jumps through time and he like stops the bullet that hits JFK or something, you know, like he's altering history, you know, really, really poorly.
That's a little tasteless,
but yeah, I think there's some fun things you can play with, and I don't know what you do as a story besides him hopping around in time. I mean, it could seem like a Bill and Ted sort of thing, or I don't know. It's like, does he just show up and he's going through World War II and then he's only there for a few seconds and then he goes to another time, or does he get stuck there? Well, I mean, eventually he'll probably have to get stuck there and I ran out of gas. And, oh, crap, they haven't invented gasoline yet. How do I get this back? I don't know.
Yeah, I think that could be fun, especially if you, like, that clearly there are some rules, but you don't care about the, like, ramifications. Like, oh, he's time traveling. Clearly there'd be people who are like, what the fuck did I just see? Or, like, that kind of stuff. Like, clearly this would greatly affect the timeline. But just, like, you don't really worry about that. It's more just, it's more about the adventure than the logic of it or whatever.
You know, he goes back to his own time and he's in a museum and there's a cave painting and someone's, you know, drew him on a motorcycle and everyone's just like, we don't know what this means. We understand what these symbols are, but this one's a mystery. Was it aliens? You know, it's one of those things. So, like, you could look at all the, like, unsolved mysteries of time and try to blame it all on this
kind of like traveling. A Forrest Gump of time travel. It's just like, oh, look at this one guy who's actually in all these crazy events or whatever.
Hits the Hindenburg. He's the one that started that. You know, little things like that.
Yeah. Okay. That'd be fun.
Yeah. Do we have a name for this?
All right. Stuntman traveling through time. Ramp to everywhere.
I was saying like a jump through history.
Yeah. Oh, time jump.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because maybe, ooh, that's, like, the first, like, that's his, like, thing. It's, like, I'm going to do, like, that's part of his show. It's, like, I'm going to do stunts through time. It's, like, and he calls it time jump. Mm-hmm. And it's, just like, all right, I'm going to jump over the Hindenburg. And he's just got, like, a little Hindenburg thing that he jumps over. Or
it's, like, that they could all be the same. It's just him jumping over a thing.
Yeah.
And it's, like, I'm jumping over a dinosaur. And there's, a little paper mache dinosaur. And he just does the same jump. Every one of his gimmicks is just a jump over something.
Or would you like the ramp is designed to look like a dinosaur, so goes up his back.
That'd be cool.
Like on his tail and stuff. Mm-hmm. Or like, you know, maybe there's just a giant dinosaur head that he has to like land through. Mm-hmm. That kind of stuff. You could do, and like part of the Hindenburg thing is just like, oh, the Hindenburg's on fire, so he has to like jump over flames.
As it explodes or something.
Like you could do some. So he's just got like that's his thing. It's just like, I'm the history stuntman. But then he actually like goes to these events and like, once again, what is like the crux of the story? But
that'd be funny. Like he's this egotistical person thinking, "Oh, I'm teaching kids about history," but he's really just doing dumb stunts. It's like, you don't learn anything. It's just like, the Titanic was a thing, and I'm gonna jump over it.
Yeah, it's got that classic thing of like he's got that girlfriend, and just like, honey, you need to, like, or maybe they're divorced and stuff. It's just like, need to start paying your child support. It's like, well, look, I'm trying, like, putting on all these shows. Like, no one likes your dumb show. It's like, hey, I'm teaching kids history here. And she's like, you're not teaching these kids anything. You're just trying to show off, like, oh, look at you, Mr. I can jump over fire or whatever. It's like, no one cares.
Yep.
And, you know, he's just a man-child who's doing all these, like, lame stunts, but under the guise of, like, oh, I'm an educator. It's like, Gary, you're a fucking asshole. That's what you are. Not a teacher. Yeah. So
that's good. Yeah. We'll say like time jump.
Time jump. This summer.
Cool. All right.
Who's a star? Who's directing?
Ooh.
Starring Chris Pratt as Mario.
Chris Pratt does not get to be in any of our This Meets That. It better be a role that's perfect for him, because I don't want to see that guy. I don't have anything really against him, but it's just like saying like, oh, a Chris Pratt type is eye rolling.
Who's hot right now? Who's a young up and comer? I feel like,
maybe a Pete Davidson.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, because I mean, he's got that slime ball look, and I can see him totally trying to say like, "Oh, I'm doing stuff for the kids," but it's just him feeding his ego.
I mean, I've seen interviews with him where he's like, "I'm really only a good actor when I'm playing a version of myself." Like, so I don't know if he could like carry this film.
Sure.
But I don't think he'd necessarily be bad at it, because of his tattoos and stuff. Like, I could see him sort of being a stuntman kind of character.
Or he could be, you know, the grease monkey, the mechanic guy.
Mechanic of his like best friend character.
I'd be okay. I mean, maybe he's a little too old for this, but I think a Jason Sudeikis could be pretty fun.
Yeah, it's not a bad choice.
Mm-hmm.
Just anyone from SNL,
yeah,
really.
Pretty much.
Just
Now, okay. Directing wise, the first thing that came to mind was what's his name? Jay Roach, who did like Austin Powers.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
So it's like you can, I don't know, he just has a good comedic sense. I could see it working.
Yeah. I mean, not to just sort of keep him in this box, but maybe I'm just picking him as someone to sort of branch out to the film world is get Derek Waters from Drunk History.
Okay.
Since he has a background in doing history comedy, use him, but give him something that isn't necessarily about, you know, the drunk people, but like give him this bigger story.
You want him to star or direct?
I want him to direct. I want to see what he can do behind the camera in terms of like a bigger, not necessarily a huge budget film, but you know, something with millions of dollars behind it, and see if he can direct a movie.
Yeah. Oh.
I mean, it might tank, but sure. I'd like to see what he's got.
I would also even say like Bob Odenkirk. He did like Let's Go to Jail and Brother Solomon, and that's like kind of the goofy comedy that I'm imagining this is. This isn't a realistic look at anything. Sure. Yeah. So that kind of slightly heightened reality.
I'm changing my, not that I really picked a star, I'm going Glenn Howerton from It's Always Sunny as the stuntman.
Okay.
As our stuntman lead, yeah. A little bit older, but still like kind of
charismatic
and can be like an attractive leading man while still kind of being a sleazeball character, because we know he's plays sleazeball characters.
Great at that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
So Glenn Howerton with Derek Waters directing, Time Jump, story of a stuntman who travels through time.
Excellent.
Boom!
Pretty good. All right. Let's do another.
All right.
That was simple enough. Do you got one right off the top of your head?
I'm always weird because I feel like I think of the same like 10 movies over and over again. It's like, no, I got to branch out.
Yeah.
Like, I wanted to be like known enough to be accessible, but also like not so typical at the same time.
It's like, stop thinking of like Steven Spielberg and stuff like that, because it's just like so easy to, because those movies are so visually identifiable that it's easy to pull stuff from.
And they're so easy to reference.
Mm-hmm. And then it's like, I think of a movie and it's like, oh, we did that director last time. I don't want to do the same director again so soon.
Okay. I got one. I can't remember if you've picked this before, but okay. I got one.
Okay. All right. Don't change yours, but because it's spooky season, I'm going to choose a spookier movie.
That's what I did.
You did?
Yeah. But go ahead. Okay, let's see what you got. Let's see what we can...
All right. Silence of the Lambs.
I went with The Thing.
Oh. Okay. No. I love this. Okay. Because
okay.
I actually kind of almost had a pitch for, you know, The Thing prequel / kind of remake with Mary Elizabeth Winstead.
Yes.
Okay. This is, I kind of had this idea for that movie and what I think they should have done, but I think this can work as well.
Okay, I'm going to let you lead and then I'll just piggyback off.
Okay. You said The Thing?
The Thing.
You did
yes.
say The Thing.
Okay. John Carpenter's.
Shit. Did he say it? No. Okay. So we have an alien that has come to Earth, and this is going to be very Thing-like. Let me just pitch this out first.
Get it popping.
One of the problems I had with the Thing prequel was it just became The Thing. It was the exact same movie. It's looking like one of us. We got to figure out a test on how to see who's real, who's not. It runs amok. It kills everybody, and it could potentially get loose. So I think something fun, because you don't have to necessarily explain the mythology of The Thing, but it would be fun to kind of learn a little bit more. So they cut it out of the ice, and it's in a block, and somehow they are able to trap it into a container of something, like a plexiglass thing, almost like Hannibal Lecter.
Yeah.
And they, not that you necessarily see it in its original form, because who knows what that is, but you see it as this hideous monster thing, and maybe it was just replicating something on its ship, because I guess in that movie it was a prisoner of a different alien, but it got out, killed that alien, and that's why it crashed on Earth.
Okay.
So maybe it looks like that, maybe it looks like whatever, but it realizes it's stuck and it can't get out, and maybe it was able to like grab someone and assimilate them. And then it's able to, you know, it can't hide. They know it's an alien, and then they're able to talk to it and get a little bit of not personality, but learn a little bit about the alien. And I think that would be really interesting. So for this movie, we would have a situation where an alien has come down. Maybe it was a threat, but we have captured it. And now we have, it's been captured for years. Maybe it's a shape-shifting alien like the Thing. Maybe it's a little more little green alien, whatever, or a gray alien. It's just an alien of some kind. But now there has been an invasion. I don't know about a huge invasion. Maybe it's like a meteor came and something broke out of it and it's trashing the world or whatever. So we have to go and talk to this alien and get advice. Ask, have you heard of this thing? It's like, oh yeah, those things are, they're pests. They infiltrate planets and they devour them within a year. And so they have to use him like Hannibal Lecter and learn about alien life and how to defeat this thing. And it's probably playing them. It's like, well, I can't really help you because you don't have the stuff to kill this thing, but maybe I can. Maybe if you let me out, I can kill this thing for you. Maybe you let me leave planet, you know, and yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And then you could have a thing where a thing, you could do a bit where the alien, it's weird cause they're both aliens.
Yeah.
Your main alien is out and is helping the team and everything. And he, like, it was like, I'll take this guy out kind of thing. And, but then he meets that other alien and they kind of like bond. And so that alien, it's not necessarily, it's like kind of parasitic, but it just, I don't know how you wheel and deal with it. I don't know if you necessarily make that alien something that he caught, that it was like, this was part of his plan to eventually have this thing hit Earth or whatever. But then it becomes kind of like a symbiote venom type of suit. And then it gives the alien the ability, the main alien, the ability to shape shift. And then it's like, oh, now I don't know who it is. And then he becomes the killer. It's like, okay, you guys trapped me. I now have this ability to change my form. And he's just going around killing like the scientists or the people or the military or whoever really holds him.
Yeah, there's a lot of ways you could play it. It could be like, you have your main alien, and then the new alien is his partner, his dog, his enemy from another planet. They could be so different. And that's a fun thing is generally when you have an alien, you have just an alien. Well, now you have two different types of aliens. And then this one, maybe it's a tall, lanky, slender man looking motherfucker. And then the invading one is more of a gloopy, blobby mess. So it's like you have two very distinct aliens in one movie. Maybe they join up. Maybe the alien realizes humans aren't so bad. There's like a lot of ways you can play this movie.
Yeah. See, I was thinking before your pitch was you make the alien a naturally shape-shifting alien. And sure, maybe you don't know its true form. But like I imagine there being a scene where like maybe he... I just imagine kind of like this glass box kind of thing, and you do it kind of like Clayface in the Arkham games. Like every time you walk by, it took the form of a different person, and you know, whatever scientist is working on it, it takes its form. So you pretty much only ever see the alien in the form of
a human.
Of a human, yeah.
Fucking and, with them, sees like someone's picture of their daughter, turns into their kid. Dad, please let me out of here.
Yeah, like all that kind of good creepy manipulative stuff. Yeah. And I mean, I don't necessarily know how it would know human language. Maybe it like touches one and sort of just like absorbs its knowledge. It's like, okay, now I know how to talk or whatever. So it killed one before they caught it or whatever. But you do a scene where maybe there's a character who gets introduced and like doesn't realize what it's looking at and just sees like, oh, someone behind the glass going like, hey, I'm trapped in here. You gotta let me out. And the person like doesn't really know that they're... I don't know how you really get this outsider into like this military science base. I don't really know. But like someone just assumes the alien got out and the person is just stuck behind the glass. So they like hit a button and it's like, oh, well now you're dead. And then they have to close down the facility and it still becomes very much a thing. It's like, we can't let this thing get away. Otherwise it could end the world, but it still has the shape-shifting ability. It looks like a person. I mean, I guess that's the whole plot of the original one. Okay. But, I didn't necessarily lean into the serial killer aspect, and I forgot about that part, so continue. All do right. your thing.
So the thing monster that can shapeshift, that has landed on Earth more recent. We have our we'll call it the hero alien, our Hannibal Lecter alien.
Okay.
Maybe he's like, say he's like kind of like poisonous. If he touches you, he kills you. Maybe he radiates something or whatever. Like, they have to keep him contained. But they need to use him to hunt down this shape-shifting one, because this shapeshifter alien is like very smart and very sneaky, and it feeds on humans for whatever reason, and it is doing like serial killer things. So at first, like, the police think they're just hunting down a serial killer, but it's a shapeshifter. They can't get a beat on who it is. Mm-hmm. Somehow they find out that it is an alien or whatever. So then our hero alien, they have to like put him in a containment suit, kind of like a Hellboy 2, you know, the gas thing suit.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's just like, look, you can come out with us and hunt this thing down because we know you can identify it or whatever. But this suit keeps you from touching people and killing them, releasing your pheromones, doing your hypnotism or whatever the hell it does. And they can like shut the suit down at any time. So he's kind of frozen. So we can't just run away. Mm-hmm. So it's like, yeah, you're going to be our expert in the field, but you're under our control. What you do with that, like, how does he break out or whatever?
Yeah. Right. Well, if you want to lean into the Hannibal thing too, it's just like, what if not either our hero alien or like the main monster is like the only way that like the main alien who's helping, like he would eat people, and that's the only way. It's not like he can just touch you and take your form. It's like, mm-hmm. he has to eat you and then absorb.
Yep, just like the thing.
Yeah. Well, the thing ate them?
Absorbs them. Yeah.
Oh, I thought he just like killed them and could like just once he like got a hold of their blood, he could like take their DNA.
He could, but he does eat them.
Oh, he does? Okay. I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about then.
Because at one point I know they like kill it and they cut it open and someone was like decomposing and stuff. And that's like in the remake,
it's been a while since I've seen that thing.
You know, they find like fillings and like a pacemaker or something that can't absorb unnatural stuff, but it does absorb you.
Oh, okay.
Doesn't make sense with like the clothing, because they're always wearing like normal non-bloodstained clothes that they wear, but who cares?
Yeah,
that's what the serial killer would be doing. He'd be turning into your greatest desire, your boss, your mom, or whatever convinces you to go into a location, and then just like sucks you dry and sucks your brain out, and now it knows everything about you, can transform into you, moves on to the next victim. So maybe that's what the cops are like eventually figure out. Oh, this victim was a homemaker. We know what she looks like. We got to go try to find that person. And maybe the alien could only transform into the last person that they ate or whatever. So it's always on the run, and it has to kill again in order to lose the tail of the...
Yeah. And it's just like, or maybe they think it's multiple assailants, because like they go to the crime scene and there's footprints. It's like, well, the crime scene of this one, it can't be the same guy, because, I mean, the MO is the same, like how the diet is exactly the same, but it's like the footprints over here are size 7, but the footprints over here are size 11, or like we found fingerprints that connect to this one, but now the killer is connected to, like, the victim was the one who had the fingerprints here, and it's like this whole connect thing, yeah, so that'd be pretty cool. Now, I don't know if you... I mean, I guess the only way for this to really work is, like, you know the killer is an alien from the jump. It's not, like, a mystery, so it's like you're... following detective characters, maybe, who are trying to... I mean, I guess the detective characters are just, like, the alien scientist or military.
Well, I think they would be, like, normal cops at first, but then the alien scientists would get wind of it. Then they would kind of barge their way in, and then you would have the newbie hotshot detective who's like, this is my case, and I gotta be a part of it, and so then they recruit him.
Yeah, there'd be, like, that one rogue scientist who's just like, the government doesn't want you to know this, we've had this thing... it's escaped. That's why you guys are having such a hard time catching them. It's because, like, this thing is not from this world. And then, you know, that's how you go, like, bring in the... we got to get to the secret base where this other alien is so you can talk to him and get information. It's like, I can sneak you in because I am this rogue scientist who has access and that kind of stuff.
And this person's a great profiler, and it's like...
the best in the biz.
The best in the biz. And you got... you know, 15 other serial killers to admit to their crimes, and we were able to find the bodies and stuff like that. So we got to bring you in, talk to this alien who's just a sneaky, manipulative fuck who's just going to play mind games with you, and then manhunt on the Buffalo Bill alien. Yeah, and like with Buffalo Bill, he's making a skin suit out of women and stuff, and this person is transforming into those people. I mean, maybe he could even have a thing where he puts them in a well or a deep hole or whatever, because he has to, like...
It's like nesting ground.
Yeah, or it's like, these people need to be... start becoming famished before I eat them, or they have to be pure frightened before I can do it. You know, whatever reason.
Yeah, you could do a thing where, like, the alien has, like, goes into, like, kind of connects to them and, like, gets into their brain, and maybe the serotonin or whatever, like, chemical you want to, like, all right, the human needs to release this level of thing, and I just slowly, you know, drain them. Yeah. And then once I've eaten their meat, I can, like, really replicate their skin and that kind of stuff. So that could be fun.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
I was going to say, what are we going to call it?
What are we going to call it? Well, first, let's get Fincher to direct it.
Yep.
Because he's got experience with aliens and psychological thrillers.
Yeah, yeah. Fincher would be perfect.
Then starring Andy Samberg.
Yeah, I think casting for this doesn't matter.
Seth Rogen as the voice of the alien.
Yeah, you gotta get someone who... Because, like, the monster shape-shifting alien, it's just whoever the victims are is who we cast. So that doesn't matter. And then when we see its, like, true form, it'll be a CGI or puppet monster thing.
Yeah.
Who plays the hero alien.
What's that? I don't even know. I mean, it'd just be...
Doug Jones.
It's just going to be Doug Jones.
Get Doug Jones. And he's been doing more acting in his movies, like... You know, they've dubbed over him for Abe Sapien in the first Hellboy, but then What's-His-Face was like, no, he does most of the work. Let him be Abe Sapien. So then he gets to do more acting that way. So, yeah, Doug Jones for that. And then...
And do a cool creature look for him. Mm-hmm. And then, I mean, you could either go, like, this scientist chick. Oh, I guess you make the detective the girl. And you
yeah,
make the
if we're doing Silence of the Lambs thing, yeah.
So we got a female character and a male character.
Mm-hmm. If she's the best, like, profile in the biz, she should be a little older.
Yeah, this doesn't need to be like a romantic link between us two by any means. No. I don't want that stuff.
Because I want like the scientist to be like Jake Johnson and the cop to be like Margot Martindale or something. Like so different that you wouldn't even think
character
that there's
actress,
gonna
Margot Martindale.
Like there's never gonna be a thought of them gonna hook up after this crazy thing. Because the scientist will probably die, you know?
Yeah, probably.
Probably.
Die to save her and... honestly, I'm okay with Jake Johnson and Margot Martindale. Let's just go with that.
Cool.
I'm a fan of Margot. What do we call it? It'd probably be some stupid, like, ominous title, like, you know, the...
It's a one-word title.
No, or just, like, the something killer or whatever, you know, something stupid like that. Killer shapeshifters from outer space.
Alien profiler, or it could be something artsy like My Time with Subject 72849.
The X-Files. Terrestrial homicide. No, it doesn't matter. They don't all need to be slam dunks. Yeah. We'll figure it out in post.
Post, yeah. I'm just going to think of a name in post.
Yeah. Silence of the Aliens. In space, no one... Or in space, there is nothing but silence of the lambs. Pass. All right. Okay. Well, I think that has potential for a cool movie.
Yeah.
For sure.
Absolutely. That seems like an easy one.
Yeah. That's a perfect this meets that. Mm-hmm. Like if you went to a Hollywood room, it's like you guys like The Thing, you guys like Silence of the Lambs. It's like this meets that.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. Get Weinstein on the phone and tell him to fuck off. And then get me someone actually in Hollywood. All right. Do you want to do director versus director before we head out?
Sure.
Or?
Yeah. Might as well. Okay.
I got one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. I don't know if you've seen this movie, but I think you know the director well enough to make an opinion.
Okay.
All right. 1, 2, 3.
Kevin Smith. James Dunn?
James Gunn's Slither. Oh.
I have seen, I think, half of Slither.
Okay. Kevin Smith's what, though?
Kevin Smith's Clerks.
Oh,
just because it's most.
Yeah.
But I what I like about this combo is I think they both are directors that clearly have an ear for comedy,
mm-hmm.
Or a vision of comedy. So I think James Gunn's Clerks could work really well. And well, and also Kevin Smith did his horror sort of grouping, which I think lends itself to Slither. I think that they both would do the other movies.
Are you saying with Tusk?
Yeah, Tusk and Yoga Hosers, I think, technically has some like horror elements to it. And it hasn't come out yet, but I think Moose Jaws is still in the works.
Yeah.
His killer moose in Canada or whatever.
Okay, okay. So the thing with Clerks is it's not really like an interesting looking movie. And James Gunn has a really good eye for visual effects and action set pieces. And it's like, what is he going to bring to Clerks that's going to... Because without changing the script of Clerks all that much, like there's not any action to it. It's all very single shot, lockdown camera. There's nothing really dynamic about Clerks. So how different of a movie is it going to be with him directing?
I think with James Gunn, like you said, I think it'd be shot a little bit more interesting. There'd be a lot more camera work going on, I think. I mean, Clerks works in its simplicity, but it is not necessarily a well-shot movie.
Mm-hmm.
I think he could definitely take the I think the comedy would be more sort of self-referential. Like, obviously, Clerks is very much in the, like, references pop culture a lot with, like, the Star Wars talk and everything. Like, it's about two dudes just sort of riffing off of each other and stuff. And I think James Gunn would be good with that stuff, but I think he would sort of be a little bit more winking to the audience. And obviously it's an original property. It's not like what, and it's the first of the View Askew universe. Mm-hmm. So it's not like what's it really going to be like, you know, but I think there'd be a lot of more meta commentary in it. And obviously, like, if you're not changing the script too much, but I think you could change it enough in a way where it be more jokey than Clerks is. Mm-hmm. I think Clerks is clearly a comedy, but it's also, I think, acted in a way that's sort of drama-esque, but I think James Gunn would go full-blown comedy. It's like joke, and go that route, where I think Kevin Smith's Slither would be clearly more tried to do more dialogue than what James Gunn does. I think that horror elements would be just about the same. Like, they're both would be fine with, like, the gross-out stuff and get weird and everything. I think James Gunn or Kevin Smith's Slither would just be them more quipping over each other. Where even though James Gunn is known for quipping, and correct me if I'm wrong because I don't remember Slither. Like I said, I didn't really finish it. But Kevin Smith's would be more about the arguments and dynamics of like the characters than James Gunn is. Where it's just like, I think James Gunn's Slither is more like, how do we survive? And here's some like funny observational humor, or am I wrong?
No, I'd say you're right. I can see Kevin Smith doing Slither and doing a lot of, like, whoa, this is just like Invasion of the Body Snatchers, you know, that sort of referential stuff.
People there'd probably be a character being high and stuff, and just sort of being like the stupid character. It's like, you don't need that guy in there.
Yeah, just the person that's like has seen all the alien invasion movies, so they know exactly what to do. I just don't know if James Gunn would have anything interesting to say about the life of a convenience store clerk. You know, I could see him maybe like if it was based more on the video store side.
I would like to see that movie for sure.
Instead of the quick stop.
Because I think these dudes are roughly the same age. Like, it would have been funny if they both sort of shot on the scene at the same time, or like they were friends from New Jersey, and it's like, okay, well, I'm going to make Clerks. It'd be cool as an experiment if you make Clerks, but from, you know, Randall's side, and just see which one takes off. And maybe they both shoot a star, because it's like, oh, they both are fine separately, but as a companion piece to each other. That could be really cool.
Yeah.
Because especially since... James Gunn came from the trauma background and doing that kind of stuff. And also, I think he did a series of, like, PG porn. And clearly, James Gunn has come under fire for some of his more, like, risque stuff, which I think would make sense with Randall. And I think, yeah, give me the James Gunn, Randall Clerk, and just, like, that way... Like, they talk about movies in Clerks, but it's like, when you're in a video store, all you're going to do all day is talk about movies. Where in Clerks, I think they talk a lot about like the customers and their relationships and stuff, and that's fine. But yeah, I think that'd be cool.
Yeah, yeah. I think I'm siding with James Gunn's Clerks, but only if it's from the video store. Whereas Kevin Smith's Slither would be fine. It wouldn't improve this our Slither that we have. I don't think he can make it better, but I don't think he would mess it up so bad that it's unwatchable.
Yeah, I think it'd probably be equally comparable movie where James Gunn's Clerks in the video store would, granted, would be a different take, different enough, and also lends itself to being in the same world in terms of style and substance, but clearly from a new sort of take its perspective.
Yeah. So you're voting for James Gunn's
Clerks? Yeah, I'd like to see James Gunn's Clerks.
Yeah, I think that's the winner. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, that was not too hard to fight out.
Yeah, I think we picked two directors who complement each other very well and have come from similar beginnings.
Mm-hmm. Now, I think like Kevin Smith would probably be better at handling Super? Is that what it's called?
Super, yeah. I like Super.
I think that's more up his alley. You know, superheroes are his thing. I think he'd be better at that. But I don't know if any other Kevin Smith... I mean, I guess James Gunn could probably do a really great Tusk.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
You know, he would make Yoga Hosers watchable.
yeah, Yoga Hosers was awful.
Bad. It's not as bad as Jane Silent Bob Reboot, but...
I've yet to see it. I keep trying to bring myself... I want to work up the courage to watch it.
It is rough. But I will say, the best joke is after the credits, so you have to suffer through even all that. All right, well, that was fun.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for everyone for joining us in another episode of This Meets That and Director versus Director. Is there two movies you would like to see us mash together and pitch something new? Or maybe you have two directors who you would like us to see who could handle the other person's property more.
Or maybe there's a new game you have that you think you'd like to hear us play about movies or TV or just any other sort of pop culture stuff.
Yeah, what are your movie games that you like to play with your friends? Well, until next time, I'm Ben.
And I'm Steve.
Thanks, everyone. Goodbye.
Let's take a pause so I can punch this dog in the fucking face.